Imagine that we're playing a game with a $100 prize. The game is interrupted. We have to stop before there's a winner. How should we fairly split the prize money? This seemingly simple question led to the invention, or discovery, of one of the earliest and most important concepts in probability theory. What I like about this story is that on the surface, the question has nothing to do with probability. It's not about randomness or chance. It's about fairness. How should we fairly split the prize money? So, how did fairness become randomness? Randomness has been a part of daily life for a very long time. People used animal bones and carved stones as dice. They used randomness for gambling, religious, or divine interpretation, to adjudicate disputes or make political decisions, and to predict the future, like a magic eight ball. But surprisingly, the basic mathematical ideas of probability theory really only started in the 16th and 17th centuries. And one of the driving questions was the problem of points. You and I are flipping a coin. If it lands on the smiley face, then you get a point. And if it lands on the chalk, then I get a point. The first person to 3 points wins. I realize that this game sounds very boring, so to make it more interesting, there is a $100 prize for the winner. You win the first two rounds, and then I win the next. But then the game is interrupted. Maybe it's something dramatic, like an alien invasion, but more likely, we just realize that this game is very boring and stopped. Either way, we can't play anymore. How should we fairly split the prize money, the $100? You can pause here and come up with a rule. But remember, you have to convince everyone else that it's fair. Arguably, the simplest option is just to give all the money to the person who currently has the most points. So that's you. You might like the solution right now, but it can be very unfair. Imagine this. We're playing to 1,000 points. I win the first point, and then the aliens invade. We're interrupted. I would get all the prize money, but we both still need roughly 1,000 points to win. That seems like a bad solution. In 1494, this guy argued that the players should split the prize according to the ratio of the current points. So in our example, we played 3 rounds. You won 2, so you get 2/3 of the prize. That's $67-ish. And I won 1, so I get 1/3 of the prize. That's $33-ish. This seems like a better solution. But then some other Italian Renaissance mathematicians, like this guy and this guy, had a pretty good counterexample. Imagine again that we are playing to 1,000 points, and again, I win the first point and then we're interrupted. I get all the money. Just like before, this probably seems unfair to you. Or you have 999 points and I have 900. According to the ratio rule, you should get 53% of the prize money and I should get 47%. But you only need 1 point to win and I need 100. So the only way I can win is if the coin lands on my side 100 times in a row without ever landing on your side. Given that imbalance, it seems unfair to split the prize money roughly in half. This is a pretty good objection to splitting the prize based on the ratio of current points. Instead of looking at how many points we have already earned, we should count how many points each player still needs to earn to win. We should look into the future. In 1654, Blaise Pascal and Pierre de Fermat exchanged a series of letters about the problem of points. They have two different approaches, but both of them know that the key is to look forward to the future, not backward to the past. They both argue that a fair solution is the average of the future possible games. And, this is a spoiler for later in the video, they both compute something we now know is the expected value. Fermat starts by noting that the game will end within 2 coin flips, within 2 rounds. There are 4 possibilities for those 2 coin flips, the 4 possible futures for the game. As Fermat writes, this fiction of extending the game to a certain number of plays serves only to make the rule easier and, according to my opinion, to make the chances equal. In 3 of the 4 possible future games, you win. In the other one, I win. Since each outcome is equally likely for Ma reasons, that your chances of winning are 3/4. And therefore, if the game is interrupted right now, you should get 3/4 of the prize money, $75, and I get $25.
And this is the fair solution.
Pascal reaches the same conclusion, but he looks just one round into the future. On the next coin flip, either you win and get all $100, or we tie, and if we stop then, we should split the money 50-50. Therefore, he argues, either way, these $50 belong to you, and these $50, perhaps I will have them and perhaps you will have them, the risk is equal. In other words, we're equally likely to win those $50, so we should split them, $25 for each of us, which gives you $75 and me $25. What I love about his style, his phrasing, is that he's arguing about the solution in the way you might settle a dispute while playing a board game with friends. It's concrete and specific. It's about what happens to these particular dollar bills, not abstract numbers or theorems. And, most importantly, it's about fairness, which is driving this whole debate. Within a few letters back and forth, you can see Pascal and Fermat struggling to build and defend their ideas. They're approaching from 2 different angles, but they land in the same place, a new concept, expected value, which has come to influence practically every aspect of our life. The math in these letters, which can sometimes be confusing as real-time thinking tends to be, was later written down systematically, textbook style, and it's now absolutely standard. Nowadays, a typical first example of expected value is your winnings from one of those carnival spinning wheels. Each segment has a specific prize. The expected value is a big sum. It's the probability of each outcome times the value of that outcome, all added together. There's a 1/4 chance of winning $1, a 1/16 chance of winning $19, a 1/2 chance of winning $0, a 1/16 chance of winning $5, and a 1/8 chance of winning $2. So your expected winnings are $2. You win, on average, $2. Another word for expected value or expectation is average or mean, except it's really a type of weighted average. For example, if these are your scores on 4 different exams, then the average is 70%. Just add them up and divide by 4. Or alternatively, multiply each one by 1/4 and add them up. They're equally weighted, all worth 1/4 of your grade. But maybe the first and last exam are worth more, 30%, and the middle 2 are worth 20%. The grades have different weights. This is a weighted average. The expected value, for example, of your carnival winnings, is the weighted average, where the weights are the probability of that specific outcome. If it costs $2 to spin the wheel and you do it a bunch of times, then you will neither win nor lose money. So $2 is a fair price. Similarly, when our game was interrupted, it's fair to give each of us our expected winnings, the probability of winning times the prize. Drawing this connection between fairness and probability theory, the expected value, was a struggle for Pascal and Fermat, 2 giants of mathematics. But now we use expected value to decide when to bring an umbrella, or whether to invest in a house, or how late is too late to drink a cup of coffee. You might not be walking around with a calculator crunching the numbers, but this perspective is baked into our daily life. Fermat's coin counting and Pascal's shifting dollar bills gave us the concept of expected value. But understanding a mathematical concept is different than being able to calculate it. To find your expected winnings in a different game, say we stop when you have 5 points and I have 2 and we're playing to 10, we need to be able to calculate your probability of winning. Here's where Pascal needed to work some combinatorial magic. I need 8 points to win and you need 5. After 11 rounds, it's possible that we're both very close to winning, but nobody has won. But after 12 more rounds, one of us will have won. So, we need to analyze what happens after 12 more coin flips. These are the extensions, the possible futures for our game. Your probability of winning is equal to the number of extended games that you win divided by the total number of extended games. Here's the problem. There are 2 to the 12th, which is 4,096 possibilities. That's way too many to write out the way Fermat did. So, how do we calculate what number of them you won? Well, you win if you get at least 5 points. So, any game extension where you get 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, or 12 points is a win for you. But of course, this is not the only way you can get 5 points. You can get 5 points like this, or this, or this, or more. There are 12 choose 5 ways to get exactly 5 points, and 12 choose 6 ways to get exactly 6 points, and so on. These numbers are a row in Pascal's famous triangle, or another person's famous triangle, depending on the time and place. The triangle is most easily described by saying that every entry is the sum of the 2 entries above it. Alternatively, you can say that the kth entry in the nth row, we always start counting from 0, is the number of ways to choose k objects from n objects. So the 12th row describes the possible outcomes of 12 coin tosses, how many ways you can get 0 points, 1 point, 2 points, and so on. If you get at least 5 points, you win. That's 792 plus 924 plus 792 plus 495 plus 220 plus 66 plus 12 plus 1, which is 3,302 possible games that you win. So your chances of winning are 3,302 divided by 4,096, which is roughly 80%, so your expected winnings are $80. 2 years after their exchange about the problem of points, Pascal and Fermat briefly corresponded again about a problem now known as Gambler's Ruin. Again, you and I are playing a game in rounds, but now we have unequal odds of winning, which really changes the problem. It's like a weighted coin. You have a 5/14 chance of winning, and I have a 9/14 chance of winning. Each round, the winner gains 1 point and the loser loses 1 point. The game ends when one person has 12 more points than the other. What is the probability that you win? Fermat replied with the correct numerical answer to this question, but he didn't show his work, which seems to be a theme with Fermat, correct answers without explanation. You can think about how to solve this gambler's ruin problem yourself, and if you want, leave your answer in the comments, but please show your work.